it's available.
All right. First item on the work session is the GIS roadmap. All right, our GIS folks.
So, a couple, I guess last year we had presented the first phase of the GIS roadmap plan to you guys, and now we've moved on to the second phase of the GIS roadmap. So we have worked with Timmons, and we have them here today so that they can present the second phase of the roadmap that kind of lays out what's in the budget documents for your CIP.
So they'll be going over bird's eye view of the report that was included.
Okay.
All right.
We'll hand it over to you.
Sure.
Or Russell. Good afternoon, and thank you very much for the opportunity to come here today and speak to you, Boards of Supervisors, regarding the phase two of the GIS roadmap plan. Again, my name is Russell Nenick. I'm senior principal at Timmons, and so I'm here really to help answer any questions that I can. With me today is Andy Fox. Andy has been the project manager on this project for the duration of the project. And so he'll be going through some of the results that we've got, some of the recommendations. And together we can answer any questions you might have regarding the GIS roadmap plan. Thank you very much.
All right, thanks, Russell. And nice seeing everyone there. Do we need to switch the... So, as Larry and Russell alluded to, there was a phase one, and I'll get into the phases and what we did in each one in a moment here. But basically, what we'd like to do is give you a high-level summary of what phase two was about, while at the same time refreshing your memory on what was done in phase one that led up to the recommendations and the plan we put together in phase two. Phase one was basically the first half of last year. We needed to get it done before the end of your fiscal year, so it was done in June. Phase two kicked off in July, and we had that done by the end of the calendar year. So that's the timing and the sequence. So basically, we want to refresh your memories on the project goal. The approach we took, which is very straightforward, look at a very high level of the assessment results, and so that was phase one you've seen, but wanted to refresh your memory on that. Then talk about the roadmap plan that you have in front of you. And as part of that, we have roadmap projects, each of them having a project schedule, budget, and overall implementation approach. And then questions throughout or at the end, you're certainly welcome to jump in. So as a refresher project goal, so what was put in front of us was the need for a plan, a three-phased plan, not necessarily 3 years, because we wanted to give you the flexibility and the ability to reorganize the plan each year, push things out so that if there's too many things going on at once, you don't have to necessarily tackle them in the approach that we initially laid out. That changes with time, obviously. What we did was we looked at all the areas in the county, all the departments in the county that are current GIS users or potential users. As it turns out, there are even some that we listed in phase one and phase two document that will benefit from the work, even though we didn't interview them. The ones we did interview and communicate with via surveys as well are listed here. So we met with folks from administration, Stephanie, Mr. David, building inspection, Barbara Crozier, Commissioner of Revenue, Renee Pope, emergency comms, Nikki, fire and EMS, your fire chief and his assistant chief, and folks in planning, sheriff's office. We had pleasure working with chief deputy there. County schools, quite a few staff there, including Dr. Tanner, superintendent, and Service Authority. So this is taking a broad brush approach, looking at all the folks.
Is there any thought in looking, talking to the clerk of the court with regard to land records?
Yeah, actually that was involved tangentially, although that was not a group we were originally tasked to talk to. We did talk really about where their records fall into the workflow for GIS, particularly because the land records obviously drive land ownership and anything that gets taxed and addressed at, in other departments. So that would be one area to expand it, but we were not tasked to or asked to work with the clerk there. So GIS roadmap. Basically, you've heard the term strategic plan, needs assessment, and other terms, I'm sure, but basically our approach to strategic planning is called a roadmap. Like any other information technology system, GIS is comprised of a number of elements. So the people who use the data, software they use to do that, hardware, computer hardware, the data itself, the policy and standards and procedures that they use to collect, maintain, use, report, and distribute and share information. So we looked at all those elements and talked about all those elements with the staff as we went through the project planning stage and did the interviews and did the surveys. Two phases I'd mentioned earlier. Phase one, the assessment phase, was done the first half of last year. If you want to think about it in simple terms, it's like a diagnostic checkup of your car. So we want to take a road trip. We kind of know where we want to go, but what do we need to do? Tires good? Do we need to change the oil? You know, so basically assess where you are now, identify where you have unmet requirements, share some best practices and knowledge about what your peers are doing around the Commonwealth to stimulate ideas like, yeah, I heard Fairfax County was doing that, or I heard Culpeper's doing this. So it's an opportunity to get the creative juices flowing, if you will, and think about what's possible, with the eye being on high value, high return on investment, not do it because you can do it, but because others in the Commonwealth have done it and have shown good value for doing so in terms of efficiency and customer service. And so in phase two, we take those requirements and ideas and say, okay, if we're going to look at things that benefit all or most of the county departments that we had listed there under stakeholders, what would the top priorities be? Things that would benefit most, if not all, of those departments. And so that's what we really focused on. As you'll see, there was quite a few ideas and requests from different departments, and so our job was to help work with them identify what their real priorities are and come up with a plan to address them. And so that's what phase two, the planning side of things, would be, and the tune-up. Phase one, as I mentioned earlier, we met with folks in person. We provided some knowledge transfer as part of our educational presentations on what your peers are doing. Followed up with survey results to verify, A, this is what they're using GIS for now. B, these are their ideas that they communicated during the sessions about where they want to go. And have them help us identify which of those are their priorities. And then any background documentation that Larry was able to provide on the current system and where data is stored, the technology used, the number of users, things like that. So really good background, and from that we came up with an assessment summary. So a number of ways GIS is currently being used. This is often very enlightening for Board of Supervisors to see, wow, I had no idea. All these departments are using GIS now. B, we're using it in so many different ways, and the individual ways are laid out in the phase one document if you're curious what those are specifically by department in there. You can probably guess based on who they are, what they're using map-based information for, like schools is doing bus routing and planning pickup and drop-off zones, things like that, obviously. Emergency services and sheriff and fire and EMS are concerned about dispatching, and commissioner revenue and building obviously are concerned about real property and the improvements on it and who owns it, who's paying taxes on it, and how do we deliver emergency services to it. So all those 58 ways are enumerated in the first document. Then they had some ideas, as I said, based on things that they'd like to do, things they need to do, as well as some ideas for adding some services or expanding some capabilities that they know their peers are doing, would like to do, but may not be efficient to do without automated computerized technology. You know, they could compile a bunch of paper maps and try to synthesize and analyze it, but unless it's an automated approach, it's really not effective or efficient to do that. So not all of these 111 are unique. Some of them are ideas that would benefit, obviously, multiple departments, and that helped guide us and focus in on those as the priority. And originally, I think we came up with about 19 priorities. Ultimately, we settled on these 16. And simplified way of presenting them here based on how they tie to software integration. So the items are near the little labeled bubble that they refer to. So for example, on the IT infrastructure side of things, we're looking at, well, what's your current server and hardware stack and technology look like based on current capacity and planning and enlargement and use of that? What kind of capacity expansion needs to happen? Same thing on data quality. What data layers do you have based on what we know from working with you guys and also having talked to the staff where there's data quality issues, there's data management issues, what are those, how do we best address those? Same thing on the workflow procedures and processes, particularly related to real property.
Talk to me about what a data manager, what a data issue is. I mean, maybe I'm having a little trouble here, but it just some of this seems like it doesn't get into nitty gritty, and maybe I need a little nitty gritty on this.
Yeah, that's fine, nitty gritty. So things like how data gets collected, so whether it's collected in the field via GPS, somebody writes down, does some field measurements with a wheel. When a property address gets assigned, where does that get logged? How does that get shared to other departments who need that addressing information? Is it communicated by phone, speakernet? Is it only available upon request, or is it pushed to them? Is there a central location? Where's the system of record? So if you say, well, we've got two maps. One says this is the address. One says this is the address. Which one's right? Maybe the clerk's using one. Commissioner Revenue is using one, Fire and EMS are using one. So the idea is really to make sure that the information you have is A, being maintained by the responsible parties. Which department is responsible and owns that data? They're responsible for making sure it's accurate. Are they using the best tools and techniques available to collect and store and distribute that? Or are there some inefficiencies that we can streamline, replace, and automate? And then ultimately, how is that being used? Again, not all the data that's GIS-based or map-based is in the GIS. Some of it's in other systems for their purposes, so for dispatching, for property assessment. So how does it get from where it's created to where it's being used? So there's some system integration or touch points between what GIS is doing, dispatching, emergency services, real property, the web. Does that answer your question?
Where are we with respect to managing or creating the data? I mean, when I looked at this earlier, of all of your bubbles and task or whatever you call them, priorities, I guess, that was the one that seemed to be the elephant in the room, both to get it to some condition where it's acceptable as well as to maintain it going forward. But what did you see when you looked at our current situation, I guess is my question.
Yeah, well, that's definitely a priority, and that was clear to us and communicated by the departments as being a key issue. It's not a tragedy. No county's or city's data is perfect. It never is, never will be. The idea is to improve upon it, standardize it, and apply some techniques that allow the system, rather than eyes, to do some automated checks and verifications so that A, it meets the rules, like addressing rules that apply, you know, odds and evens based on distance, naming techniques and things like that that have to be applied. So that's what we really recommended as part of some of the first few review roadmap projects is to really get a handle on that. Make sure we know who owns the different data layers. So A, what are all the data layers? Who owns them? Meaning who's responsible for maintaining them, keeping them current, keeping them accurate, because they're the person responsible for the source of record on that. And then make sure that they have the tools they need to maintain it and utilize it, analyze it, do run reports, run numbers. They have the training to do that. And they've all expressed, hey, yeah, we could use more training. And the fire chief in particular said, training is probably one of our biggest needs in the mapping technologies. We know it can do great things. We've seen our peers do it. We just don't know enough. We've got some tools, but we don't have enough training, and we need more training, obviously, to know what the possibilities are.
What, there's one component that I don't see mm-hmm. in all of this, and that component standing before us this evening.
I'm sorry?
That component is standing before us this evening. Timmins.
Yes.
Where does Timmins fit in the training and the understanding component of what Timmins provides mm-hmm. to the different departments?
Yeah, we have, and look, if I may jump ahead here, it'll show you in all of these roadmap projects, some of them more than others require training. And in all of them, and let me jump really far ahead here for a sec, because it'll answer your question. So here's an example of a roadmap project. We wanted to make sure the plan was designed for you guys, for the county, and we identified where it would make sense for either the county, and like, for example, task 1, 4, and 6 are this kind of yellow color. Those are the high-level steps that the county staff can do on their own without really any outside consultant help, although it would be helpful, obviously, to have someone.
Let me back up a
okay,
little bit.
Sure.
What, my real question is not that. It is, in this education level, mm-hmm. where does Timmins fit in to come to the level that they need to be for the county usage? And I'll just use one example.
Okay.
There seems to be a disconnect in understanding ranges and addresses within ranges, mm-hmm. as well as structural placement from the field people within your organization to understand where we need things on maps and on address ranges.
I know that's been a point of long-term communication, and we continue to recommend following NENA standards, national standards on addressing, which some of the county's practices in the past have not followed. And so I guess there needs to be, and has been, some guidance in that area for that. So that's where the disconnect seems to be. Is
well, I think there's also a disconnect in an understanding from Timmins staff. This is where my concern is. I understand we have deficiencies. There's no question about it. There are always deficiencies on both sides of every story. Where is Timmins at with correcting Timmins' deficiencies? I guess is what my question is.
Yeah, and I guess that's the purpose of one of these projects, and I'll go back to this one here. The improved 911 addressing. That's an opportunity for us to work with your staff who are responsible for addressing, to look at the current procedures and processes, and that's something that we're deficient on. I would suggest that seeing firsthand who's doing what, how they're doing that day-to-day would be really helpful to get a better handle, and that's the purpose of these roadmap projects, is to say, hey, here's a high-purpose or high-priority need. This is something that requires a deeper dive, a more detailed analysis. So let's work with your staff to identify what the current procedures and tools are, and then develop the goals and objectives of how to move forward.
Okay, and that's the two-way street,
yes,
there, right?
Yes.
Okay, and that's really all I was asking, because okay. everything you were addressing mm-hmm. was on the county side of the table.
Yeah.
And that's I wanted to make sure that we're all on the same page as far as you are part of the team.
Oh, absolutely.
And you need to be, where you're deficient, need to work on that as well.
In fact, if you look at any of these six projects that we recommended, they're all collaborative. They're all things where it's a mutual education. The last project was a high level, where are the priorities? This level is, what are the priorities you need to focus on? How are we going to move forward with those? And invariably, it involves a dialogue on any of these.
That was really where my question lay.
Complete on it, yeah, totally agree. Thank you, sir. So phase two, as I mentioned, and I'll get into this one here, for each project of these projects, we either devised a roadmap project that addressed one or more of those. Some of them were already in progress by the county, for example, document management and work management were things that were either in progress or would be in progress or were budgeted for, so they've been addressed in some capacity there. But ultimately, we came up with these six projects, and you've read the details, but they touch on all the key elements. Like the first one, manage the plan, is all about the hardware and infrastructure side of things for storing data, for communicating it, for making sure the different information systems you use across the county talk to each other. Strengthen the organization. One of the things we need to make sure is that for each of the departments that create, contribute, and share data, that they know who's responsible for that, that they have the tools and training needed to do that, and they have the authority and responsibility to do that. Mobilize GIS, obviously, a number of your departments use, collect data in the field, not when they're sitting at the desk in the office. So it's important that they have access to the complete record when they're in the field, as well as be able to add to it, correct it, and leverage it in the work that they're doing in the field. And certainly your broadband initiative will help in that area. And that project involves identifying what your priority mobile needs are, be they for emergency services or dispatching, what those applications are. Are there off-the-shelf solutions that meet their needs? Maybe some customization, configuration tools to really prove high value and high return on investment for leveraging the data in the field. The one at the top there, share parcel and address data, is the other one. It's like, how do we, address information is important to virtually all departments. How do we make that process work from a system standpoint? You have a process and procedure now. You have someone responsible for doing the addressing, and there is a process in place for distributing that information or requesting it. Well, how can we automate that between the systems so that there's not human intervention in some cases, so that when certain ones information's updated, it's automatically pushed and available from the centralized system of record. So that all the departments expressed an interest in being able to better leverage and share information, in particular parcel address information. We already touched on 911 addressing and how together we can better understand the process now and devise a game plan for moving forward so that everybody's comfortable with how it works, we know what the standards are, and they're being applied.
Just a quick question on the 911 addressing. Mm-hmm. Town of Orange does their own. Mm-hmm. They seem to have a revolving dartboard. That it just, Nikki, is there any rhyme or reason that you know of?
Okay. Yeah.
Is this something that we're just going to leave alone and take a guess every time we get an emergency call in the town of Orange? Or is this something that they could buy into? I'm just curious.
Yeah, I'm thinking when this is being recommended for deployment, might be.
I know that the town has contracted separately with Timmins because I shared information with them, but where they are with that, I'm not sure.
Right. Okay. Fantastic.
But so we did include them and shared that contract vehicle with them, so they could hopefully be a part of
it. Fantastic. Hopefully they can come along in some degree of semblance with
it. It would make sense to invite them to participate in that effort, yeah. And expand data, and there were, every group we talked to had a laundry list of, boy, wouldn't it be nice to have at my fingertips a map of X, Y, or Z. And so what we wanted to do is make sure we, A, captured what some of those detailed requirements and needs are, and that's laid out in a short list in the first document. But what we recommended was a project to, when this happens, knowing there would be a time gap between when that those needs were communicated and when this effort may actually take place, that A, it's refreshed. So make sure that we have the latest, greatest information on our priorities. And then work together to develop a game plan. What is the source for that information? What's the most efficient way to get it from paper to computer? Who's going to maintain it? How are they going to maintain it? Do they have the tools and training so that it doesn't get stale and stays fresh? And so that's really to make sure that the data needs moving forward are there. We did know or did learn that the county has the data they need to do their job, whether it's in a computer or on paper. Obviously, there's opportunities for efficiency by getting it all on the computer, in particular if you want to share it between systems. It's a lot easier in computer than on.
What do you see as the high priorities for new data?
We put together a hit list, if you will, in the first list, and I don't remember all the particulars, but a lot of them had to do with, for example, fire and EMS. They had a large number of data layers that they wanted to be able to have at their disposal in the field in computerized form. It has to do with some of the things that Nikki and Larry and I were looking at when you came in, fire quads, run boxes and run orders, and how to do some planning, some fire planning. Things such as where you might put your next fire station, those types of things.
One of the things I thought I noticed somewhere in all of this was the idea of knowing where the kids are in terms of school bus planning. Does that begin to deal with privacy issues in terms of how many kids might be in a given home or anything like that? I mean, are there certain layers of this stuff that would not be available to the public?
Absolutely, absolutely. And that's always the way. Clearly, there's some data layers that the sheriff's office, for example, and public schools cannot, will not share specifics outside their group. And it's always based on a need to know. The way the GIS is typically set up in a county is if it's department specific or even person specific, like there's only one person in the schools who can see layer X, then it's controlled, has controlled access by login. Sometimes it's anyone in the department. Sometimes it's anyone in the county who has a need to know or right to use, but it's not accessible to the public. And so you can control those different levels to person, group, county, or anyone. So good question though, and certainly a lot of times what you see is bus stops. You may know how many kids are being picked up or dropped off there, but no attribution of names or where they actually reside.
But if you're, yeah.
But if you're in the school, yeah, you want to know.
You want to know that this residence has got two kids in elementary and one in middle school.
Absolutely. And they have that information that they're using now for some.
But it doesn't flow into the GIS system currently. Right. And if you try to do that for planning purposes, you want to keep it only to the people who deal that.
And so for the roadmap projects, the six we came up with, we wanted to make sure we provided some high-level guidance so that the county, as well as the consultants, ourselves or others that you may work with on these, know what's the purpose. Now, what are we really trying to get at? What's the value? The high-level primary tasks so that you know, okay, well, here's how you start, here's what you're going to collect, here's what you're going to analyze, and here's the results, and what are the deliverables for this project. So the basis of really the budgeting and the scheduling in this that went along with the project. Any assumptions? You know, assumptions, thankfully none seem to be terribly constricting. Possible risks, relatively minor. Projects, but we did want to call those out and identify those for discussion as projects get kicked off and assessed. And for each one, and slide we came back to earlier, we wanted to identify those tasks where it made sense for you guys to take the lead or for a consultant like us to take the lead. In either case, the project is a cooperative effort. Obviously, there's a way to knock this down efficiently. We want to try to leverage the value of having your staff involved. But we want to minimize the impact of their time on this, because technical folks go, hey, well, we could do that ourselves. We work with other counties and they go, oh, we can do this ourselves. Well, yeah, you can, but you've got a day job too, and it's not this. So that's why it makes sense to do it collaborative, involve them to the degree they need to be to make the project successful, and give us the guidance, and help educate us on what their needs and procedures are so that we can make it successful. And so we did approach it from that perspective, meaning collaborative. We did identify the number of staff hours we feel it would take to knock down each of these projects, as well as consulting budgets, any hardware, software, data services, anything in there, both for the initial project as well as for any potential follow-on. So for example, some of these are a deeper dive and assessment on some of the requirements that need to come out of this, and what might the follow-on cost be. If you're recommending building a pilot mobile GIS mapping solution for fire and EMS, what are you thinking of? What do you, you know, what might that cost for a typical proof of concept pilot for a real high priority, real high value implementation? And so we did include those numbers for planning purposes.
I did look at your cost numbers, but I tried to follow your totals here throughout the rest of the your, and I couldn't always make a connection. Do those totals that you have represent everything that's in here?
Yes, sir. The and that's maybe where the disconnect. This includes not only the cost of the initial project, but also any planned implementation that might occur in that. The details are in the back end of the book.
Well, as I said, I was looking to bring the details up to forward, and I couldn't couldn't necessarily sort them through that way.
So for your benefit, this particular slide shows you high, medium, low estimates for the three phases, as well as the totals, if you were to look at all three phases, what that might be. So those are there, the number of hours that your staff would expect to commit if we accomplish all those projects. And then the next slide shows you the year or phase one in more detail. So as where I was going with that is up top you have, we've broken down initial consulting support. So what that might cost for manage the GIS plan, strengthen your staff's mapping abilities and skills, and improving some procedures related to 911 addressing. And then any upfront or follow-on training, software, hardware, cost that might go with that. So so each of those year or phases roll up to, at the bottom there, the numbers you see in this slide here for each of the phases.
At the end of these phases, it wasn't clear to me where we, how to characterize the position the county would be in. You know, it seemed to me that we never really staffed or budgeted for this being a inside operation for the county. That it was always going to be a we were relying on outside assistance much as we do today going forward. And I don't know whether we've looked at that and determined whether there's a right answer. Do we do this, you know, exclusively in-house? Do we build that capability in-house? Do we minimize the in-house capability and go to the other extreme and have it primarily a contracted service?
It's a hybrid approach that really makes the most sense, and we've seen this across the Commonwealth and across the country. There are certain things that your staff do that we can't do. I think they know the data, it's their job. They own it, they maintain it. So on things like that, we want to make sure that it's not, you know, obviously it's part of their job, so it's not, I'd really like to go make a map. It's like, no, I need to process this data, I need to compile, I need to run some numbers on assessment. So for those types of things, we want to make sure the staff have the software and training they need to do their job. Some of the higher end things, like, what does the architecture look like now, and is that going to support our mapping needs once we get the new communication center in place? Schools start using this. Rapidan starts leveraging your data set. You start working more closely with Orange, the town. Now, those types of things, where are we going to need to go then? So we want to make sure there's an opportunity in there for a collaborative approach every year to revisit the plan, see where there are needs. But basically, you know, nobody wants to hear, no city, no county wants to hear, oh, well, you need a data GIS data guru in each of your departments. You're not going to hire. No, we can't hire that many people. What we can do is make sure that each department knows what their responsibility is based on the data they own and are responsible for the county's benefit, and that they have the tools and training. So we're basically taking staff already doing that job now, empowering them with the software and training they need to do it even better than they're doing it now. And they are doing a great job now, but we want to make sure they have the ability to keep pace, because the demand's growing, staff's not going to grow at the same pace. So that's how you leverage us as consultants for looking at the high end. What's the big picture? Where's the direction we want to go? Where's technology going that we can leverage a year, two, three, five down the road? Because you could go, like we do, to professional conferences and training all the time. If your staff did that, plus try to stay current with the technology on, you know, by researching and things like that, they wouldn't get their day job done. So that's where it makes sense for us to work with.
I guess I'm trying to sort out the difference between the ongoing day-to-day operations and I'll call it using the capability or using the system versus, you know, future enhancements. I mean, it sounds like that, if I got the right image, that the other than as an end user or supplier of data, that staff is going to be not terribly involved in the sort of the day-to-day ongoing functioning of the system. Now, maybe I've gotten the wrong impression. I mean, it looked like we are going to need, under the plan, we're going to need your help every day to turn the system on and make it work. That our people will pump information into it,
yeah,
or extract information from it, but they're only users. They're not owners, unless
the system actually resides here, with the exception of the web-based mapping system that we host for you. That's the thing we turn on every day and make sure that's working. But it's really the software that is being used on staff desktop. The data they create is being stored and managed on your servers here. We get a copy. The stuff that goes to the web, the bulk of it, I mean, all of it, resides here on one computer server or another. And any system integration or interfaces that exist now or may come as part of the plan would be done here.
And that's one of the weaknesses that we're having, is the integration between systems. Having our ERP system talk to the CAMA system, talk to GIS, and there's a lot of integration pieces that aren't functioning as well as they could, because of what we have, so moved around or not.
So if a person's working in one system and the data that he's creating or he's generating there ought to go into GIS, but it can't.
Or it's going into GIS, but it's not going into the tax system information. Or the parcel information is not getting back into the GIS. It is, but it's...
Or it may not be happening as fast as it's updated. You know, certain departments update their data throughout the day. When does this GIS system see that it's been refreshed? Maybe the next day, overnight. Maybe the next week. Maybe the next month. There's always a lag when the systems aren't fully integrated in that. And that was one of the...
Well, and that requires another specific effort to enter it if it isn't integrated. In other words, if you're working on one system, and now you got to say, well, I've done this, but now I got to go put it over here.
Right.
Duplicate entry.
And that's the chart that I made two summers ago that showed data being in four different places and not corresponding well to each other. That's the problem we're having, and that was really what prompted us to hire Timmins to come in and help us figure out how to consolidate it, how to procure a system that works well with a new PMA and with all the different departments, and to give us those governance standards so folks know how and what they enter impacts other departments in the county.
Well, I guess that's one of my concerns is, you know, if we maintain all of the systems we have now Separately, and yet try to take the output or the data, at least from those systems, and put them under one umbrella, calling it GIS. To me, that looks like a pathway to a cliff. I don't think that, in today's technology, that doesn't make any sense. I mean, you need a database, and then, you know, everybody plays in that same database management system kind of a concept.
It's not necessarily a single centralized physical box where all this resides. It's a virtually centralized. So in other words, Renee and her, you know, data in the Commissioner of Revenue system, that's her system of record. But there's no reason why that can't be available to, as a copy, as a replica, to other systems to use. So there is certainly going to be a centralized repository of information, but not necessarily all on one box.
Well, some of her information is available to the public.
Right. Yes, sir.
Who owns the piece of property, sure, and how much it's assessed.
I think one of the things, and I'm just glad Stephanie reminded me of her sheet, the map of all these users and things, is that we did the roadmap because we had these disparate databases that weren't talking, but we're on the cusp of buying a new CAM system.
The CAM is in the CIP for this year, and phase one of the GIS system is in the CIP this year, and we've been working with Timmins because we also have the Eagle mapping issue.
We have the 911 that we, and so there's a CAD issue, so we've got at least a process to that, whatever. I'm going to go out on a limb here because I'm looking at my colleagues here. Whatever we acquire going forward, there will be forethought given to the integration of it into the overall system. So we've got some legacy systems that we're having to transition out of, and that the idea is that whatever's acquired going forward is going to add.
Everybody in the Commonwealth at one time or another has had the same issue. So system vendors that we're talking about here, have gotten smart, saying every bid I'm going to see GIS integrations requirement, interface to the Commissioner Revenue System, interface to the CAMA system, facilitated data transfers to dispatching systems that people use here in Virginia. So they've gotten smart, and it's getting easier. So as time goes on, it won't have to be done under the hood. So a lot of these interfaces will be already exposed by vendors.
Well, it's a better way of, I mean, if a guy's got to do a certain amount of, to do his regular job, but it's also putting system in the system, that's good. Because if it doesn't, that's another thing he has to do, and he may not have time for.
Right.
And I also will say, I mean, there's a staffing component here. I mean, I think we've talked about a GIS coordinator, or at least somebody that is able to do that as part of the job. I think you could also have other IT things for this person to do. But that's, you know,
that's part of where I was going with my question, because in the best of scenarios, there's a significant staff that's going to be required to make this operate going forward, whether it's county staff or contract staff, consultant staff, or both. You know, this is not a half a person twice a week kind of a task, you know, going forward, because even if someone owns the, and I'll pick on the Commissioner of Revenue because I don't see her. She owns a certain slice of this data and updates it and has responsibility for it. But, you know, once that becomes available in a database form to other users, the demands for accuracy and timeliness and all these kind of things get triggered. And so you're dramatically increasing the manpower that's going to be required to make that happen, and the demands for quality. And so, you know, this is not just a plug-and-play kind of I've had some experience with some things like this before, and I know something about where the trap doors are. And so there's a staffing component of this that's going to be ongoing forever, and not small.
But the point is the cost of that additional staffing going to be worth it in terms of save time elsewhere, better data for other activities the county has to do?
And that's why I was asking earlier, about the Timmons portion mm-hmm. of the staffing, because I know currently there is quite a bit of redundant work to be done. Something will go out mm-hmm. and it comes back and it does not, and it may be correct in your eyes. Mm-hmm. It's not correct with what we deal with here in the county. So it has to go back and back and forth to get worked out. And it does. And for that accuracy purpose and everything, it does drive the man hours up. And whether it's county staff or contract staff, absolutely, Mr. White.
I'm not, you know, I'm not saying it's a bad thing. I'm not saying it won't be worth it, because I think that certainly the experience is that it does pay dividends, but it's a sizable task.
For those reasons, that's why I think we're trying to bite off as much as we can only chew in portions. But every time, every phase, every year, this we get the hardware, we do the capital spend. There's an operating spend that's going to be a tail on it.
That's the piece that we don't have any real visibility in yet.
Well, and that's why I think, at least from an organizational structure, it was having the IT department, because of that being the overarching function of doing that, even though they're not a user of the data per se.
Seems I could foresee issues, and Brian's going to know what I'm talking about, because we're talking about this upstairs a few minutes ago, but where if we're relying on the individual departments, and as Jim said, once that comes out where everybody can get to it, you sort of exponentially raise the importance of accuracy
and timeliness and
lots. Yes. So I would say I don't think having the individual departments own their information, I don't think it's going to work. I don't think it can work, because every department is going to be first and foremost simply interested in making the information work for them. And
you got to police it somehow.
As we were just discussing upstairs, there's one department that is, the way they're doing things is causing a problem for everybody else, because when you go into the GIS, there's a blank there, and nobody knows what that blank means. And you have to root around to something that should be right there in front of you. Instead, you have to root around and play Sherlock Holmes to figure out what the blank should be filled in with. So I'm not at all sure that the idea that we're going to have all these departments owning different pieces of the data, I don't think that's...
And operating on different systems.
Yeah, well...
That complicates it even further.
Well, that's a computer complication, but you have umpteen different departments, and they've each one got their own sort of, I don't mean this the wrong way, but sort of their political environment, and that where they want to do things a certain way because it makes their life easy. But then when it gets shipped up to the big central database, you know, everybody else can be scratching their head trying to figure out what it means.
To Mr. Johnson's point, when we just saw we were using the GIS and there were some coding issues on one of the parcels we were looking at. But I think one of the things that we're trying to do is back to the value. There's GIS value to the county's operation. I think it is, in my opinion, it can do. But getting there is that we're having to struggle with legacy systems that have a lot of issues with the data quality, the data availability, and as we go forward, we're going to be buying new systems, and by golly, they will be integrated. Then there becomes the staffing piece back. You know, how much do we contract out? How much do we do it in house? I also think there's a policing function, and that's back to this coordinator mm-hmm. function that somebody is then, you know, as part of their job is to make the quality assurance over all of this.
But none of that addresses my point. None of that addressed my point. Okay? That has nothing to do with the point that I made. So to the extent that you were responding to what I said, you didn't.
So...
Because you can have everybody on the same hardware, you can have everyone address all those other issues, and you're still going to have a different culture in each department, whereby they decide that, well, we want to do it this way because that's best for us, but it's not what's best for everybody else. So
some of that is an internal struggle that we have with those that are, you know, in the county administration. We have constitutional officers and some of that.
You're sneaking up on understanding the issue.
Yeah. No, I understand the tectonic plate.
Well, but there is a way which says we're gonna take the central database and we're gonna make that separate, and we're gonna put someone under the county administrator in charge of the central database. And what we get from all these feeders lines, we are going to then put it in the correct order when it gets there. I mean, that is a way to address that.
And that's the more normal way of doing it. These legacy systems, even if you're piecemealing it over time, getting them to be modernized or compatible or whatever adjective you want to use, you know, that's a painful path, even if it ends up being successful. The elephant in the room, and back to my first comment, is the data and the creation and control and policing and credibility and timeliness of the data.
Quality control as it gets into the major database.
Yep.
And I don't know that I could have ever seen that be decentralized and work effectively. It has to be centralized to work. And I think that's what you're saying.
Yep. Data governance, and that's how a lot of counties are knocking it down, and how we recommend in these projects for the first two phases in particular, look at that. What do you need from these different legacy systems? What we know is what each department wants and what they create. And so we can create a standardized, centralized data model that these other systems feed, but you have somebody at the enterprise level sitting over that, you know, babysitting it, policing it, and saying, okay, everybody's doing their job, it's falling into the data model, and then other systems that pull out of that, whether for dispatching or for the public website, are looking at that centralized, standardized database that everybody has confidence in and that is being managed by the enterprise for the organization's benefit.
Yeah. Well, we talk about what's going to be useful for the departments, et cetera. How is this going to help the citizens of the county?
Better service and information online. Commissioner of Revenue, Circuit Court Clerk information, if and when they can do that without having to pay a state fee, to provide those land records at no cost.
So the commissioner, the citizen is going to get his tax bill more accurately, more rapidly.
And it will be lower.
I don't think that's...
Well, Beck, I think one of the things is, as you all know, one of your priorities next 2 years, but also I wouldn't see you all changing that, is the concept of the digital citizen anytime, anywhere, anyone. And I think the board is right in saying that priority is assuming whatever you can do in person here.
Self-service.
You ought to be able to do online. And so this geographic information actually feeds into that. Back to Mr. Johnson's point, I think it's going to be important for the board to set as priority, as a policy, that the taxpayers are providing the wherewithal to make this happen, and that all the users, whether they're independent or have to agree or work on this in a collaborative, unified way, that there's not an ability to
kind of like Wikipedia.
Yes, sir. that they
how'd that work out?
Yeah.
But how they could unilaterally change things.
I mean, it seems to me like that there needs to be a discussion that focuses on that narrow part of this issue. You know, how do we get from where we are today to a reliable database? You know, the other parts will fall into place.
That's right, and that's the... There's one project that focuses on that spaghetti diagram. That's where you are now. We know through discussions at a high level where you want to be, and now we've got a plan how to get there. We just need to implement it.
Any wisdom
coming up on 5 o'clock?
Okay.
I guess the purpose of today was to let you know we're starting down the road. We budgeted some money for capital. And, I think the issue of how the users, particularly those that provide critical base data to this, are making that our decisions are all not working against each other. Mr. Chairman, members of the board, we had one other item, the agritourism restaurant item. We could push that on to the back or regular meeting, depending on how our timing is with the other items. So,
okay.
Is that open.
Hang on. How do we get from where we are right now on this question of the GIS to take the next step? I didn't hear that. I didn't hear anybody say, go forward and do wonderful things yet.
Well, no, we budgeted money, Stephanie.
Yeah, I heard
it in the CIP.
I heard that part, but
are you asking? I think Jim's asking a political question. I mean, this board has to make a decision.
Well, it may be partly a political question. I'm really asking a question of, do we know what the heck, where we're going?
Yeah. Right.
And I don't think the answer is positive at this point. I don't know where we're going. I have lots of questions and concerns, and I don't know that we're on a path from where we are today to address those just yet. I mean, I don't like to call another meeting as the answer to a dilemma, but that may be, we might need a follow-up work session to get a little bit more convinced, maybe it's just me, but convince me that we're going to get out of this where we need to, what we need to get.
What was the dollars that are budgeted?
$200,000 for 2018, and then we proposed $200,000 for 2019.
And what was the $200,000 to need for next year?
It was the phase one, which was, since CAMA's in the same year, to look at those strategically and figure out what needs to feed what, governance, training, that first year or the first phase.
There was some hardware in there, I think. I'm not sure we're ready to go buy stuff.
Yeah, I think we need to decide what we're trying to accomplish before we start buying tools.
Yeah, I mean, the first big decision is, are we going to, as the key objective, to create a single manageable database? To me, that's the first question. If the answer is yes, that takes us off into a path. If the answer is no, we're going to rely on all these dispersed systems and get what we can out of them, that's a different path. And I don't think we've made the decision to simplify it between those two paths just yet.
Saying that, yes, we're going and we're building the capacity in terms of the server to put that on there, but when we take this legacy system and either interface it or replace it, I mean, those are look to me to be more further downstream steps. As I look at it, we're just trying to get the basis so that we move down that path. I don't think we're going to stick with the legacy systems forever. We're going to stick with an integrated system of some form.
We need to buy a CAMA system. I mean, that's going to happen.
Or a GIS that beats CAMA or CAMA that beats GIS. You know, we need to think of that strategically to see which way the inflation
goes. But Lee, there's a difference between saying we're going to continue to allow each department to generate their numbers and send them up to this database, or whether we're going to say send it up there, but then there's going to be a filter at that database. There's going to be a person there.
I thought that was in the recommendations to bring another staff on for that.
I haven't heard that.
Why don't we do this? Let Stephanie, myself, and Larry, and Josh come back to actually itemize what phase one is. And maybe do a little bit deeper dive on that.
Sounds good.
I think that would be helpful.
Would that be helpful?
That's the answer I was looking for.
There you go. You dotted the I across the T. Thank you.
Part of my motivation was...
Stop talking.
give me your shovel.
Enough said, we've moved past 5:00 now. Now we'll figure this out.
Gotcha.
I have direction.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
And then we'll take the agritourism up. Sorry, Josh. You'll be here at 7 anyway. Mm-hmm.
You ready to go?
Yes, sir.
Just lost my appetite.
All right.
Call the meeting to order. If you would please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Turn the right way this time.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, that would be my first question before we begin. Are there any additions or deletions from the agenda?
Yes, sir. I'd like to add a 9C, Germanna Wilderness Area Plan, proposed zoning, and an update on the preparation being made in Town Hall.
Okay. Any other changes?
I have none.
Anyone else?
Move to adopt as modified.
All right, motion is second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries 5-0. All right, on then to special presentations and appearances. Service awards.
Yes.
Chairman, we have three employees to recognize today while you're making your way. We have from the Orange County Sheriff's Office, Deputy Joseph Adams, who is receiving his 5-year service award today.
All right. 5 years. Thank you very much.
Oh, we got to get
you. You don't get off that easy.
Not unless you're those secret people that can't
put it. Oh, no. Thank you, Deputy Adams. We have two other employees that are recognized today that cannot be here. Deputy John Berry is also from the Sheriff's Office, and he's getting a 5-year service award. And from our Social Services Department, Brenda Borsig is getting a 10-year service award, and we'll make sure that they're made available to them.
All right. Next item on the agenda is the business spotlight. Stacy Fincham, owner of Patriots of Virginia Pond.
Afternoon, gentlemen,
ladies.
I want to thank Orange County for the opportunity to come up here today. This is my personal first business that I've opened completely by myself. Little about myself, I'm Stacy Fincham. I'm the owner of Patriots of Virginia Pawn and Gun, located at 32383 Constitution Highway in Locust Grove Town Center. Family's been in Orange County for 7 generations. Graduated right here at Orange County High School, joined the Army with aspirations of serving my country and getting out of Orange County. When I left the county, I realized real quick that it was home. I went around the country, went around the world. Couldn't get back here fast enough. I opened Patriots of Virginia Pawn and Gun October 2016. My business includes retail sales and 30-day collateral loans, which means got to put up collateral to get a loan for 30 days. It's usually small digits. It ain't nothing massive by no means. Retail side of my business focuses around firearms accessories, ammo, tools, and outdoor equipment. Plans for my business is I'm about 6 months, as soon as Mr. Dotson opens another building, I'm doubling my size by double. The new building is in its first stages. Hopefully, we'll have something going here soon. I'm also going to expand my business to an online system. People come in and want to sell any item, rare items, different kinds of items. I have eBay accounts, Buy You accounts, gun broker accounts, where I'll take it, put it up, sell it, package it, ship it, and I get a percentage of the sales. The other thing I'm doing is in the back of the building, I'm actually going to open a bait shop for the guys. I do a lot of fishing. A lot of guys around the area, like, can't find minnows, can't find bait much anymore, not in this area. So I'm going to put a small bait shop in the back. Hoping in 2 years I'm expanding, hoping a whole nother shop. I'm looking at Gordonsville right now. I'm just going to see how this one goes on that end of the county. Then maybe I can start another one on the other end of the county. So that is my business. somewhat of a plan I got going. So I didn't know if y'all had any questions about anything. So, all right.
Very good. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Thank you. Good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you, Stacey. All right, next we have the unveiling of historic marker, Jason Woods.
Gentlemen, thanks for having us here today. This is Miss Ware, Miss Jane Ware, for if those of you that haven't met her before. Well, she's pretty well known, so you may well have seen her around. So what we wanted to talk to you guys about today was the unveiling of the new historic marker scheduled for June 24th. It's a Saturday at noon at the intersection of Church Street and South Madison Road. It's just a few yards down from where the Love artwork is in Taylor Park. That's going to be the new location for this historic marker. And the gentleman that it will be honoring is Captain Andrew Maples, Jr. He is a... He was a Tuskegee Airman, a native of Orange County. His home site is actually, I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, Ms. Ware, but the marker is going to be as close to the home place for their family as it can be. So that's going to be a very important thing for the location of the marker. And as an Orange County native, he was educated at Hampton University as a pilot. He actually flew home from Hampton University to the Gordonsville Airport to tell his family that he got his pilot's license. I learned that in talking with his surviving sister, Doris Walker. So she actually told me about that, some pretty cool personal stories about him. He went on as a Tuskegee Airman, served his country in the Second World War. His plane suffered a malfunction and he crash landed and passed away. His body and the plane were never found. So he was posthumously promoted to captain, awarded the Purple Heart, as well as the Air Medal for his meritorious service over his career. And we are pleased to be unveiling this new historic marker in Orange County, which will bring our total over 30. We have more than 30 historic markers in the county as a testament to the resources in the area. And Ms. Ware has been the one who has been spearheading this effort to have his memory honored in this way with this historic marker. So I wanted to invite her to elaborate with any more information than what I had and talk a little bit about anything she'd like to regarding the unveiling.
Yeah, I think you covered most of it that I know of myself because I'm younger than you are. You know more about it than I do. You can find most of the information on Google. I have a little information here that y'all might want to see. That.
Thank you, ma'am.
Oh, it's too big. Some of the spelling might not be right. This does a drag.
Okay. Thank you.
I know that. And the town has been very helpful to me, supporting this and everything. I appreciate all that. All the ones that have, Jason put it on the website and everything like that. Everybody I asked just came right over to help out and everything. Because it's a big thing for Orange. You know, we didn't have no Tuskegee help. Here at Orange, but I think he had another brother that went there, but don't have no information from her on him. She didn't want, she just want to get this over with first before she stopped. And I just thank everybody in Orange, you know, for help supporting me. And it seems like they're going to go all right. If I didn't get that program straight, I had three or four drafts. Thank you all for your time.
One more thing I wanted to add. I believe you gentlemen have a copy of the blog entry that's currently available on the Orange County website, on the Visit Orange Virginia website, I should say, the tourism website. It's on the homepage there under the blog section. Also, went out and met with Ms. Ware and Mr. Cooley from the town and Mr. Bond from the town and Ms. Ware's husband and some other folks who are involved in the planning of that unveiling again on June 24th. And it's going to be a very good event. I believe the Orange Community Band is going to be playing for that event. And there's supposed to be a flyover from the Commemorative Air Force, I believe, and P-47 Thunderbolts. Many folks think of the Tuskegee Airmen and the P-51s, and that's correct. But in other operations, they did fly the Thunderbolts. And Captain Maples when his aircraft failed. It was actually a P-47 Thunderbolt. So we'll have a flyover of the actual aircraft that he was, one of which he was piloting during his service.
When I first heard about him flying to Gordonsville, I took him to check the airport out over there when I was coming from Gordonsville one day, and a few guys was over there, and they was tickled to death. And I said, you know, y'all might could fly over when we had this unveiling. They was into it, you know. I was too. He said, yeah, that'll give us some more recognition for our airport here because we want to get it up back up again. And we made plans for that. We'll start over there, you know, have a little something for the children, free rides and everything, and then come on over here to the ceremony, you know. But Mr. Cooley found another pilot of airplane, you know, during that time, you know, it was closer to it. But Gordonville people were ready to do it, so I just want to give them a little recognition of that, you know, and thank them for their time and everything. And we're going to have a reception at the American Legion Hall following this ceremony. All of you are welcome. I'd like to see all of you.
Very good.
Do you gentlemen have any questions about the event or Captain Maples or anything we can answer for you?
No,
thank you.
Thanks
for having
us. All right. Paperwork. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Ms.
Ware.
Thank you, Jason.
All right. So next we have a thank you letter to Locust Grove Middle School Leo Club.
I should have just stayed up.
You know, this is wearing Jason's Parks and Rec hat.
Yes, I switched hats during the walk up here.
Okay.
This is Miss Arima. She's the teacher representative for the Locust Grove Middle School Leo Club. And what we wanted to do was thank them officially for their help in our recent Michael's Mile Now in Color event. As you may know, we've in the past had Michael's Mile as a fundraiser for the Michael's Gift Scholarship Program, as well as the Orange County Parks and Rec Foundation. In the past, it's had some mixed success. We've had, one year we had a decent attendance, the next year it was down. We skipped one year, and Ms. Aramish contacted me and said, you know, the Lucas Grove Middle School Leos want to help out with Parks and Rec to do some kind of a project, and that was a pretty quick fit, I believe, to revitalize Michael's Mile. And so it was the Leo Club who came up with the idea of including color powder in this run to as an added aspect to it, which I think was the main draw that got us such improved attendance. Our attendance actually increased 600%. So if you want to put it in percentages, it was extreme attendance increase. And it did allow us to raise funds to support those two goals, the OCPR Foundation and the Michael's Gift Scholarship Program. It was a great event. The Leos, they took the ball, ran with it on getting sign-ups. They were at parent-teacher meetings, everything, getting folks signed up. She would bring me registration forms, and it was just amazing. And then they came out and helped the day of the event as well. I got to, I guess, reward them by letting them throw color at people, which is it's a lot of fun. And we had t-shirts made for the event, and everybody left with their white t-shirts smattered with different colors. And we just wanted to thank them for everything because the event would not have been nearly as successful without their assistance, and they really and truly did revitalize this event for us. So it's good to see the youth of Orange County Public Schools helping out with something like this and doing a really good job of it.
Mr. Chairman, there's a letter, if you wouldn't mind come down and presenting her and
yes,
then get a
yes,
picture.
I was kind of wondering when.
Yeah.
It's like I saw something there.
Yeah.
Now I have a question. What is a Leo?
Leo Club is a cub to the Lions Club. And we are a community service organization, and we do a lot for Orange County. We're busy. And we keep adding and adding and adding.
Now how many of them are moving up to the high school?
Probably about 15 of them.
Ooh, good.
Yes. We have 6th, 7th, and 8th graders that participate. So it's wonderful, and the kids really do enjoy it. And I keep trying to go out in the community and say, what can we do?
Thank you very much for helping to sponsor it, though. But I know a lot of work that is for the sponsors of the school. So thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. So you need to come over here.
appreciate us being recognized because the kids do really work hard and they really do enjoy this. So thank you.
Well, it's good to get them involved early. That way
yes.
They can take our job later. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
All right, next I believe we have a resolution in recognition of the White Oak Run Baptist Church. And it says you're the fourth pastor. How many gazillion years have you been there?
27.
Wow.
Wow. That's four.
Okay, well, let me read this resolution then. Whereas located in Rapidan, Virginia, White Oak Run Baptist Church was organized in 1867 and has diligently served its members of Orange and surrounding counties for the past 150 years. And whereas Reverend Jacob Phillip, the church's fourth pastor through the past 150 years, has served as senior pastor of White Oak Run Baptist Church since 1992. And whereas White Oak Run Baptist Church, that is hard to get at, has consistently grown, and I practiced last night, has consistently grown in both membership and programs and services with its dedicated leadership, outreach efforts, and community engagement. And whereas through its organization, White Oak Run Baptist Church has been able to establish and shepherd the following ministries: annual Thanksgiving Senior Citizens Luncheon, Vacation Bible School, men, women, and church-wide family retreats, back-to-school events, weekly Bible studies, Youth on Fire for the Lord, God's Men of Mission, missionary ministry, educational ministry, tutorial services, scholarship fund committee, healing the hurt ministry, community outreach ministry, praise team, children's nursery, sports ministry, transportation ministry, food closet, clothes closet, and more. And whereas through its missions, outreach, and civic endeavors, White Oak Run Baptist Church has helped make Orange County and surrounding communities a better place to live and worship. And whereas White Oak Run Baptist Church has proudly served its members and local communities, fulfilling its Christian mission and assisting citizens in Orange County. And whereas White Oak Run Baptist Church is proud of its humble and mission-serving heritage and is to be congratulated for its 150 years of dedicated Christian service and accomplishment as it continues to minister and serve its congregation long into the future. Now, therefore, be it resolved on this ninth day of May, 2017, that the Orange County Board of Supervisors hereby commends and congratulates White Oak Run Baptist Church and its congregation on the achievement of its 150th anniversary milestone.
Thank you guys so very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, I won't be here for the 2 months.
I'll try for 175.
Yes. Okay. Next thing is the consent agenda.
We need to get an oxygen tank to set back here for the chairman when he comes back from reading one of these resolutions.
Yeah.
Kind of winded.
Motion approved.
Second.
I have a motion and second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Okay, motion carries 5-0. New business. Proposed source of funds for CSA, Fire and EMS, and RJDC 2016-17 expenditures. Glenda. The finder of monies.
Yes, she found a buried chest somewhere full of gold bars.
Well, as you know, we have some areas of this year's budget that we were concerned about needing additional appropriations for. And in this memo, I've tried to address three of the largest ones of those. The largest one by far, of course, is the CSA program, and we've talked about how the usage of that program has increased so dramatically that now the potential expenditure overage is over $1.2 million. The local share of that would be $650,000, with the remainder coming from state reimbursements. But we have identified some potential revenue sources to fund that difference. $150,000 would come from additional real estate tax revenue, and that would be the difference between what we estimated would be billed for real estate and then what was actually billed for real estate, and then applying the collection percentages. We also have $272,000 left in our contingency at this point, so that's another potential revenue source. And our sales tax, as you know, has been very strong this year. So I think we could get about $227,000 from that line, and I might have a little bit more flexibility there because I do have one outstanding issue. I think I have a true-up bill for medical expenses coming from the regional jail. So I, in my mind, thinking that that could be $25,000-$30,000 more that I need to potentially use that contingency for. So I think I could then increase the amount coming from sales tax revenue by that amount and still be okay. The second area of concern was the Rappahannock Juvenile Detention Center true-up. And at the end of May, our usage of the facility was still well in excess of our budgeted amount. However, it had come down over the last 3 months from what it was. So I think I previously reported to you it might be over $90,000, close to $100,000. Now it looks like it might be only as much as $80,000. And, you know, that is the high side. That's as though they had spent their entire budget. So I did identify a revenue source that we could use for funding that, and that was local recordation tax. We've already actually collected $80,000 more than I had budgeted in that line, so I know that money is available. And the numbers matched up nicely. The other, the last project that we knew we had a budget problem with was the temporary location of the fire and EMS department. Kurt had reported to you previously, I think, a spreadsheet showing that our cost, we might need an additional $38,000 or $40,000. So the proposed funding source for that would be our project development line within the capital project fund. It currently has a balance of $199,000, and in addition, in the 18 budget, we had appropriated $106,000 to that line. So even using the $40,000, we'll come back to an available balance of $265,000 in FY18. These are ideas of how to deal with these budgetary problems, and we thought we would present it to the board tonight and get your feedback, and then come back at the last meeting in June with the budget amendments themselves if you feel like this is a reasonable plan for dealing with these.
You want to steal it from somewhere.
That's one question I have with the contingency fund. I take it you're not aware of any other, how many days, whatever day, number of days we have left in the month.
The regional
lurking
jail is the one that I know that's out there.
The outstanding. In fact, that was part of Glenda and I's thinking through this, is that we wanted to get this to you tonight, and understanding we had a few more days that something could pop up between now and then, and if nothing, you know, other than this jail matter, the contingency would hold firm on that. But we wanted to wait to the last possible minute before you all amended the budget.
I think most of the departments are pretty good. I mean, I've talked to the fire and EMS and sheriff, you know, some of the larger ones, and I think they feel okay. So I don't expect to get, you know, any more unexpected, but.
This looks okay to me.
Necessary.
Where we are now.
Yeah.
Not like we have any decisions to make other than
no.
Moving it from one pot to the other.
No, it's really just a bookkeeping.
Which shall.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
I would say that we need to add steel gloves in your budget for next year, so when you juggle these chainsaws, they don't hurt so bad.
Yeah, that would be.
All right, I see no old business. Department Director, Constitutional Officer Report, Finance Quarterly Report.
That's what you get. So, this sort of feeds right into the earlier conversation. But you have had your quarterly report for a couple of weeks now, I think. And of course, it's just reporting through the end of March. Revenues were higher only by 0.45% over the previous fiscal year. And general fund property tax revenues were at 60% of our budget estimates, but only reflect a 1.1% increase from the prior year, which is about $263,000. And that is, you know, sort of in line with our estimates. When I was talking about real estate earlier, having the $150 to spend, I mean, that would be a part of this $263, but this includes all the other taxes, personal property and machinery and tools and all of those. Our sales tax is looking strong. The total category of other local taxes increased by $359,000, but sales tax revenue, which is in that category, was up by 17.6%. And recordation tax was up by 18.2% at that point. It's now higher than that. Motor vehicle.
Question for you. Sales tax is an example. Is it possible to drill down into that and do some analysis to figure out what that's telling us, where it's coming from, you know, make sure it's not a one-time.
It is, and I have been, it's been doing so well that I have had, I have been looking a little deeper into the reports. I mean, the Commissioner of Revenue has the detailed reports, of course, but.
Does that tell you which organizations have provided it?
Okay. Is it mostly retail stuff? Is that what you're seeing? It's not. I mean, I know sales tax is predominantly retail, but some there can be big ticket items in there as well.
Right. Well, I mean, one thing that jumped out to me was having a new company like Homestead Building.
Right.
That has helped tremendously, I think, for Orange. Walmart's still, you know, going strong, and just in general, I think things are doing really better. But having a new
green
industry
application
like that is certainly a help.
Yeah. Well, it's that's an interesting metric to use to look at the overall economic activity.
Right.
Glenda, where are we from where you forecast in for fiscal year 17 to what it's looking like it's actually going to come in 20 year 17 compared to what you forecast for 2018?
Well, I hadn't.
Or to make it simpler, what did you forecast 2018 versus what you forecast 2017?
Right.
Did you pretty much leave it level?
No. I did, you know, there's some growth built into there. I think I used 5% overall for other local taxes. But, you know, you can see that some particular local taxes are outpacing that. But I used 1% again for real estate tax, and, you know, no reason to really think that's going to be significantly different. So my estimates for, my overall estimates for 18 are higher.
Are they higher than what we,
do I,
we finally got this year?
Well, that's the $64,000 question.
Yeah, that's.
That, it's true, you know, that's like, and I almost have to, I haven't really done an analysis.
Can you check that?
My gut is that it's going to be that it we are doing better this year than what was originally estimated.
I know. I'm just
wondering,
how does that better relative to what you're estimating for next year?
It's probably going to be pretty close.
Okay.
I mean, that's really my off the.
Can you Can you check that and get back to us next meeting?
Yes.
Let us know.
Mm-hmm.
That's going to be kind of good information to have as we enter the next year, because these big ticket items that we're running into are we know we're going to run into them again next year.
It would be nice to know that that the estimates for next year are actually leveling from the actuals of this year.
Mm-hmm. I can put that together for your next meeting, so we can look at that a little closer. In the area of building permits, of course, we're seeing the increases there, 14% or 29,000 over where we were the end of the third quarter last year. In money and property, we're 33% over where we were last year, so that's an area we're doing better. Ambulance fee revenue is kind of one of those that's a little bit up and a little bit down. At the end of the third quarter, we were down by 1.6%, but I feel like it's trying to hold its own. It may come in by the end of the year with our budget estimates, or it may be a little less. And again, I think that has partly to do with individuals moving to the high deductible plans, where we're not able to recover through the insurance when in the past we might have been able to get a little more. Miscellaneous revenue, we had a decrease, but that was mainly because of the excess funds from the sale of delinquent property tax properties. Animal shelter donations have been down too, and they were down by about 17,000. We had state categorical aid, of course, was showing the variation between having the $300,000 incentive for Aerojet in FY16. And then the federal aid showed a little bit of an increase just because of the increase in activity of the Sheriff's Department speed enforcement grant. On the expenditure side in the general fund, the biggest change was probably in the transfers to other funds category, and that was a net effect. We had two increases in that category. One was for the carry forward funds for the school capital. That was almost $900,000. In addition to that, there was the transfer for capital and debt that was from the excess general fund reserves. That was $3.6 million. And then those two were offset by the fact that in FY16 we had transferred the approximately $1.5 million that was the unbudgeted revenue from the last tax increase that we had. Law enforcement, like I said, that category has been doing well budgetarily. They're well within their budget, and a lot of that is thanks to the fuel prices that have continued to be lower than what we've budgeted. One of the largest areas of increases is the corrections category, which we talked about last time. Both the Central Virginia Regional Jail and the Juvenile Detention Center reflect the increased levels of contributions. As well, the CSA expenditures show a 51% increase over the prior year. And then that Planning and Community Development Department category shows the decrease of the pass-through of that Aerojet incentive payment. So, overall, general fund expenditures were at 66.5% of budget estimates at the end of the third quarter, compared to 64% for FY16. So our expenditures are running a little bit ahead of where they were in the previous year. In the school fund, we had a remaining local contribution of $10,600,000. For operations and $174,500 in local capital funds at the end of March. Collected revenues for the school funds total 59.6. That was compared to 60.2% last year. and expenditures were at 62.4 compared to 62.2 last year. Social services fund looks very similar as far as the percentages and looks on track with their budget estimates. The debt service fund reflects the new bonds from December and the payoff of the 2007 bonds. That was $25,265,000. And so by the end of the third quarter, the county has spent 97.7% of the budgeted appropriations, which was similar to where we were last year. Most of the activity is done by then. In the insurance fund, it seems that we are holding our own. However, I'd say the last maybe 3 months, invoices have been well over $600,000, and the one that came in today was closer to $700,000. So although we are holding our own, I'm not expecting to add a lot of fund balance there, or, you know, there to be a lot of change in the amount of reserves that we have at the end of the year. But we are watching that closely. In the capital project fund, the regular activity is going on there in our regular capital project fund, but I did add the pages for the new capital project fund that's specific to the 2016 bonds. So the project for the public safety complex, the radio system, the broadband, all of that is in here reported for the first time. And we have put the budgets in there for that, although they're very broad categories, and, you know, we're going to be working with Kurt and the other project managers to maybe break down the budget into a little more detail. In the airport fund, things look pretty typical there. The capital projects that were originally budgeted for this year were delayed. And the fuel was budgeted at prices that in reality we've had lower prices for fuel. So, you know, it's lower on the revenue and the expenditure side. In the landfill fund, both our build accounts and our cash collections have been ahead of budget estimates, and that seems to be in large part related to the increase in construction activity. When it comes to cash balances, our overall available cash balances were $2.4 million higher than at March 31st of the prior year. And I've included the chart and the numbers for the cash, the available cash, in the back of the report. I've also included similar information for the bond proceeds, because it's not very interesting now, but as we get to spend down for the different projects, I thought you might want to be able to follow that. We really haven't spent anything other than issuance cost at this point. So, but with the purchase of the property on the horizon, you know, that should be moving fairly soon. And then the last thing in the report is the juvenile detention center usage. And you can see that at this point, at the end of March, I was estimating that the true up could be as much as $97,000. That's come down from the when I got the monthly report for April and May. So that's looking a little bit better than it did. And that's really all I wanted to point out to you specifically. Are there any questions?
$2.4 million. Year over year, is that do you have any feel for how real that is, or is that just something that's maybe something's running a little different?
It could be timing differences. and we won't really know until we get everything recorded for the year. I have been checking at the end of each month, running through that same calculation we did with the budget as far as the school's contribution, what that might be. And the first 2 months, I came up with estimates that were slightly over what we had originally estimated, which I think was $20,180,000. But then this last month, I came up slightly less than that. So it's not substantially different from where we were estimating at budget time. But there are all kinds of things that are going to play into that year-end figure that we just won't know until we get the expenditures recorded.
Are you talking about the school system there?
I was talking about that as far as the local contribution to the school.
I think Mr. John was about the 2.4 million cash on hand.
Yeah, you said there was 2.4 million more cash on hand than last year.
Right, right.
Is that?
But
is
well, that I guess what I'm saying is. Whether we end the year with 2.4 million more.
Are you saying it's dependent in large part on what the school?
Dependent on the timing
okay.
of that whole cash movement.
And it's okay. Just so I understand, so you're saying it's dependent a lot on the school system.
Right. Just because that is such a large expenditure
okay.
for the general fund.
All right. Gotcha.
And then she and I have been talking about and through Munis monitoring to see. The projection that was built into the local contribution, you know, and true up what you know the board prepared to do that. So right now, barring anything unforeseen, we're not the variance shouldn't be too far off of what we projected.
So that would argue that the 2.4 is that would argue in the direction of the 2.4 being a fairly solid figure to judge year over year. Correct. Okay.
I feel like overall, you know, we have over $6 million appropriated of general fund balance with, you know, 3.7 of that was the excess general fund reserves that were being just transferred out. Those funds are going to remain in our cash balances, you know, even though we've now taken them out of the general fund. So,
you've made an accounting move, but the cash is still in the bank.
It's still in the pool of available cash, yes.
Look at the bird hole in our pocket.
It looks like we got plenty of help with yes. holes in our pocket.
Yeah. Yes. Got people drilling.
Exactly. Got blow torches
there. We don't need to help ourselves.
No. Okay.
Thanks, Glenn.
Thank you, Glenn.
Thank you.
All right, nothing for the county attorney report.
Yes.
So, county administrator's report. Sir.
Yes, sir. Mr. Chairman, members of the board, I have three items tonight. The first has to do with a revision to the four county players lease. As the board may recall, there was an original 2008 lease, or a lease from 2008. I don't want to say it's original because they've been using the facility for 40 years. We started working on this about 2 or 3 years ago, and it went through a dormancy period, and then it was brought back to work drafting. I have before you, which is the final iteration of this, and I've shared it with Debbie Owen, the president, and she's only had one question about whether this would affect their having. Birthday parties or events there, you know, being settled, and I said no, that doesn't apply to those type of things. So, the next step, the county attorney's looked at it, approved it as to form, is for you all to authorize us to advertise a public hearing for the July 11th meeting. I've been communicating with Ms. Owen; they will be here that evening. I didn't necessarily see them be here tonight.
So. Do we need a motion or just a...
Yes, sir. Authorize me to schedule a public hearing on...
Okay. I move to authorize said public hearing.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Thank you, gentlemen.
Make it so.
All right. The next item is just... And I'm my plan is to make this a recurring item while we're in this due diligence phase with the public safety facility site acquisition from Ms. Taylor. Nothing really to report. I know Kurt walked the site with the sheriff and a few others, the architects, Wiley Wilson and Draper here last week, I guess. It was week
May,
before.
May 30th.
Yeah, you were gone last week. So. And
well, the only thing I have to report is after we walked the site, we being Wiley Wilson, Draper, Aiden, Sheriff, I sat down with the two consultants and we kind of talked through what the scope of work for our due diligence would be. Since then, I've been waiting on a proposal from them. I just got it about an hour ago. I don't think we're ready to execute it because I have questions in it, but basically what we intend to do is a phase one environmental assessment, some geotechnical boring, some wetlands delineation, and obviously the survey, which will also include topographical survey. I need that, and 1 foot contours for us to get moving with the site design. It's not a terribly large amount of money, but the surveying piece of it is more than I anticipated, so I'm waiting on additional information to better understand that, and then I'll pass it on to Brian. But that's where we stay in this.
All right. Given that we've got some things to go through, I guess the contract for due diligence, if the board can give me some authority and some flexibility, if Kurt and I feel it's a reasonable price, we can go ahead and get that started, right?
I intended to, so that we can expedite this, and thank you, Brian, what I should add to what I just said. We don't yet have a contract with Wiley Wilson for the big project. I'm supposed to get the first draft of that tomorrow to start reviewing it. I thought what we'd do with the due diligence is use our annual contract with both Wiley and Draper Aiden to get this moving. I mean, 90 days is a pretty short window to get this stuff done. I would like for it all to be under the blanket big contract, but that's just going to take too much time. So that's how I thought we would move forward with this, just to keep it going.
Can we say what the ballpark figure is, so at least there's some comfort?
$50,000.
$50,000.
And the majority of that's the survey.
Surveying
piece, so
for the 32 and a half and the five-acre piece.
Why would this survey be?
That's what I don't want. It's way more than I anticipated, yeah. So I need to find out.
I mean, it seems like it should be fairly straightforward.
The topo we talked about, Drake Raiden has a drone. That's pretty quick. A lot more efficient than it used to be. I mean, they'll have some field work, but the drone does the majority of the work. I just say that one of the questions I have to get clarified, and I might need Tom's help on this, is Draper has mentioned that to carve off that 32 to 34 acres out of the parent parcel, they're not going to obviously boundary survey the entire 200 some acres, but they're saying they have to take it 2,600 feet. I don't understand what it is they're proposing to do, so I need clarification from them. I was just speaking with Josh a little bit. I don't know what, Tom, is there anything you can add to what's necessary beyond the 34 we are trying to purchase out of that 217?
No, I don't know what they're talking about.
Okay, neither do I. So
I just did 2 acres for 585, so if you multiply by 16,
yeah,
I get $8,000 at the most.
I mean, I know the topo was going to add to some of this, but not that much.
I mean, I know there's a. I mean, part of the problem I wonder if is that the parent parcel has perhaps never even been surveyed. It may be part of the issue.
Maybe.
But even so, it doesn't seem like carving off a piece that lies along the road should be.
As long as there's sufficient legal description as to referencing the parent tract.
Right. I mean, the issue of whether the corner in the back 40 is correct is not really, doesn't seem
relevant.
But
Gentlemen, if you're okay with it, I mean, we're going to work this thing down, but just give me the authority to go ahead and sign it, and I'll communicate back to you what the dollar value is. But there's some of these things with the 90 days going.
I expect the clarification to come in tomorrow, and then whatever other discussions we need to have to get this to a more reasonable price.
I mean, my concern is justification for that survey.
Yeah, but right, and this document is basically just words, and they need to give me a breakdown on the task and hours, and so that I can better understand it. I mean, I feel confident that we're going to go below this, and it has to be a misunderstanding somewhere. But
would help me understand this. Would they actually, is Draper Hayden actually doing, they're talking about doing the survey themselves?
Yes.
No.
Yes, Draper Hayden is doing almost all of the due diligence work, with the exception they are subcontracting out the wetlands delineation, because they don't, neither Wiley or Draper have that expertise in-house.
Well, I think we need to get some, if we can't get good answers on the, really good answers on the survey, we need to maybe bring in a local surveyor to get their 2 cents worth on this, because
they're aware of it and have some interest.
Yeah, yeah. We don't need to reinvent the wheel just because Drake Raid's never heard of it.
And
they only charge $585 for 2 acres.
I have confidence that we'll get this below the mountains.
Okay. I don't have any problem with what Brian's asked 3 times for.
I don't either, but if it doesn't look reasonable, I think the idea of looking local.
Yeah. Part of my, I think, is to get the geotechnical and the wetlands going, because in the plats.
Oh, that's right. And the other thing that has to be subcontracted out is the drill rig for the geotechnical board.
To get that mobilized.
Oh, that's fine, but that survey amount is.
All right. Well, I'll take that as consensus of the board, and Kurt and I will proceed accordingly. The only other thing, and I'll be working with the county attorney on the public hearing for the land disposition to Ms. Taylor, that 5 acres more or less, whether we need to have a plat as part of that exhibit, or we can just show a delineation off the tax parcel. We're going to get all this timing done, and so I may be scheduling this public hearing without coming to you all first, if that's okay. I'll certainly keep you informed of what I do, but I don't want to miss any time. Okay. That's all we had right now, and the walk on the site went fine. I mean, there wasn't any apparent.
Was that a walking of the site or a driving of the site?
I was riding
the site.
Okay.
I just wanted to clarify that.
All right, the last thing I had, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, I've put out, I sent under separate cover copies of the draft overlay district language for our district for the Germanna Wilderness Area Plan. Mr. Frame, Mr. White, Mr. Crozier have been working on this. Mr. Johnson, Mr. Goodwin, this is the first time you've seen these documents. The steering committee, I think, is pretty comfortable with the language in there. This ordinance, these overlays only apply to the Germanna Wilderness area. These will be presented as part of the public town hall that we're talking with all the consultants and getting everything lined up for, I think, which will be a good informational meeting. The last thing, and I'll let the other three supervisors weigh in, but I think there would be a real interest in convening the board, the planning commission, and the EDA into a large work session, probably sometime in later August, before this goes through the public hearing process, so that everybody can be informed about these zoning districts and work through in a work session format to have everybody there, because this is a significant step. Did I, gentlemen?
Well,
all right, that's all I had. Just an FYI, likely we will be convening a broadband authority meeting in July. Mr. Pickett is finishing up his work, and that's after June 30th, so we know what that means as far as our grant. So we'll.
Okay. No
here. We have any board comment?
Yes, I do. Gruber Wilson has resigned from the RSA board. I think you may have already know that. And today we had the RSA board meeting that during which we raised the rates effective June 15th. Yeah. Roughly between 10 and 25%. I think 20% water down at the east end, 10%. And 20% on 20 and 15, and then 25% on Gordonsville sewer. And according to the Orange County Review, it's all Mark's fault.
Yeah.
That's pretty good.
Yeah.
You already there.
I think they were talking about the Green County system.
I'll ask Jeff to issue a correction.
Yes. I've already notified him.
One comment on the health insurance for the jail. We're still going to pursue in the future a cap insurance, but what was presented, and we had them go back for, I believe it was a 6-year period. It would cost us more to have the insurance than what we paid out, basically due to the fact that, like all insurance, they're not there to serve the people that are buying it. They're there to serve the companies. Mm-hmm. So what we got presented with was not a viable solution. So we'll continue to look in the future, but it's not a real popular thing for jails yet. So but we're still hammering away at it.
Coming, I was waiting for anyone else. So, okay, I want to see about bringing a work session in on solar farms, seeing as they are popping up, and I actually have property under contract in another county, and we haven't really ever talked about it. I do know several people on the eastern end of the county have been contacted, so I think something we need to sit down and talk about and understand more fully, because it's coming.
I absolutely agree with you. I've been contacted as well. So
they are busy. They are buying stuff up left and right.
Yeah, and they are quickly pursuing it. So I think the sooner we can know we've been busy, but being proactive on this is definitely going to be better than being reactionary.
Yep.
It's something I would like to better understand as part of that, and maybe this is something we ask the county attorney to look into, is, you know, we're going to have to operate within the state code, and there, at least in the past, there have been a lot of incentives and tax credits and all sorts of other things that basically regulate what we can and can't do with respect to these things, and it deals with property tax assessments and all sorts of things, so.
And federal regulation too.
So and there are federal. So part of this, we need to understand, you know, what our constraints are with in terms of state and federal.
Yes, how small our boxes.
Actually, it isn't really so much a constraint issue as taxation issue. I mean, they built these things; they're pretty much tax exempt. But I'm not aware of any laws that require us to give zoning approval on these farms.
Well, what is the zoning, too? I mean, I'm not even sure. Is it ag?
Well,
it's got the word farm in it. So.
Well, that's the tricky part is figuring out if it even fits in any of the use groups that we have.
Right. So, I mean, there are any number of issues in terms of.
Supervisor Goodwin talked to me about this, and Mr. Crozier and I had a couple conversations a while back about solar farms, and I asked Kelly. Write down Kelly's last name.
Kemp.
To do a little quick top research, I think this is going to break down into several areas. There's the taxation issue, there's the land use issue, and then I think one of the things that Mr. Crozier has focused me on is potentially emergency services issue, particularly with wildfires, and then also if these run a 20-year life cycle, what happens to the panels at the end of them? You know, the company goes up. I think I understand from someone that there are individual LLCs that are set up for each one of these projects, not an umbrella company. So what does that mean? So what I think we'll do, we're going to have this on the 27th work session, and we'll break it down, and county attorney's got a role, Josh and I have been, right now it's a special use permit that we know, and then kind of work this up from the staff level and then bring this back to you on the 27th.
And I've already done two of these in other jurisdictions.
Is there,
can we tax the equipment?
Anything above ground, you can't.
Well, there are megawatt numbers that, and they purposefully stay below those numbers. I think it's like 20, I can't remember if it's 20 or something, but as long as they stay below that number, they're pretty much tax exempt. The only revenue we see is during the construction phase, you know, because they do take some time and they do involve quite a bit of construction work, and so the only real revenue bump you get is during the construction phase.
Okay. And I'm not even certain how our SUP is currently structured fits.
Yeah, we.
I mean, I've heard it. I've heard everybody say you need an SUP. I'm not convinced.
Well, if for us to allow it may require text amendment language. I mean, that's
something. Well, that's to look at. That's part of it. I mean,
don't they fit?
Unless we call it ag.
What?
It's a public utility.
Public utility. Doesn't say solar farm.
The two I did, it was a private LLC that launched it. Once it was all done, Dominion took it over, Dominion Power.
But that's not what these are going to be done under power purchase agreements from what I've read so far.
That may be.
And so it's not a public utility. It's just a private company. You know, it's Joe's Farm, solar farm.
Is there any information, we're going to the legislative session, anything that's...
I don't think calling something a farm makes it a farm. I mean, I could have Johnson Tire Farm, you know, I'm not sure that's legitimate. I understand what you're saying, but...
It's an accessory use to a farm, that's what it is.
Anything that would be useful to zero in on our legislators, saying, hey...
Well, the thing is, we don't have any duty to approve these things.
Right.
So, I mean, it isn't like cell towers. The feds have tied our hands quite a bit on rejecting cell towers, although you could still use good zoning practice to reject cell towers. I'm not aware of similar legislation when it comes to solar farms.
That's good to know.
But there's been rather extensive discussion for a work session.
Right. Yeah. And I know Alma.
That sounds like a good idea. Work session.
Has just finished
we
working
can stop
on
talking
that.
About it now.
That's right.
And Spotsy, I would say, has done something since these things are all over.
I just learned yesterday before on Monday that the largest one is put an application in Gloucester County, 900 acres. And so one of the things I think Albemarle has come up with some performance standards that they're holding the solar farms to. So we'll kind of do a scan to see if there are any performance standards out there that we can get copies of to show you what other localities.
Why don't we have a work session on this?
Yes, sir. Yeah. June 27th.
Okay. Anything on the informational items? Hearing none, I would assume nothing then. Appointments to boards, commissions, and committees. I would like to nominate Bob Wilbanks to take Duff Green's position on the BZA, and his wife Beth Wilbanks to go to the library board.
I would nominate Mason Clark and David Lamb to the Parks and Recreation Foundation Board of Directors.
Any other nominations?
Not yet.
Okay. Case I would look for a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Anything for the calendar? Nothing? In that case.
All right.
Let's read the magic words and go into closed.
Got a nice long one tonight. Whereas the Board of Supervisors of Orange County desires to discuss in closed meeting the following: discussion of performance of a specific public employee, discussion or consideration of the acquisition of real property for public purpose and the disposition of publicly held real property, where discussion in open meeting would adversely affect the bargaining position
or negotiating strategy of the public body. Discussion concerning a prospective business or industry or the expansion of existing business or industry where no previous announcement has been made of the business or industry's interest in locating or expanding its facilities in the county. Discussion or consideration of investment of public funds where competition or bargaining is involved, where if made public initially, the financial interest of the government unit would be adversely affected. Consultation with legal counsel pertaining to actual or probable litigation where such consultation in an open meeting would adversely affect the negotiating or litigating posture of public body. And consultation with legal counsel employed by the public body regarding specific legal matters requiring the provision of legal advice by such counsel. And whereas pursuant to sections 2.2, 37, 11A1, A3, A5, A6, and A7 of the Code of Virginia, such discussions may occur in closed meeting. Now, therefore, be resolved that the Board of Supervisors of Orange County does hereby authorize discussion of aforesaid matters in closed meeting. Need that as a motion.
So moved.
Have a motion and a second. Don't know which one is which, but
Allison will figure it out.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. We are in closed.
Allison, do you need me to email you that language when I do it? Or?
Yeah. Okay.
All
right. Need a larger server.
It's the closed session.
So moved. Second.
Motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All right. Closed session is in recess. At this point in time, we first order of business is public comment. Is there anyone signed up for public comment?
Not for public comment, no, sir.
Okay. I'll close public comment. Public hearing. Hearing number one. Josh.
You'll see Thomas's name on the staff report here, but I let him go on vacation. He's been so good lately. The first public hearing before you, gentlemen, this evening is a special use permit application by the Christensens. They live just east of town at 17085 Constitution Highway. The property is zoned residential. It's our limited residential district. And accordingly, having farm animals does require a special use permit approved by the board, so that is why they're before you this evening. Now, real quick, the Planning Commission held their public hearing on this back at their June 1st regular meeting. It was pretty quick. There were no speakers from the public. I will note the draft resolution that was included in your packet is actually missing the condition that the Planning Commission approved to add, which I think is highlighted in blue on the resolution that's in front of you, the hard copy. So with the addition of that condition, the Planning Commission did vote 4-0 to recommend approval to you all. Staff have recommended approval as well. If you have any questions about the conditions or staff report, please let me know.
If I saw the correct property, looks like it's bordered on one side by other residential properties and then a fairly large agricultural tract surrounding the eastern or northeastern edge. Is that? Yeah, okay, thank you.
Questions for Josh? Okay.
Well, so I believe the applicant is here this evening. If
that
like to
that was the next question. Is the applicant, would they like to put in anything? No? Okay. In that case, open the public hearing. Do you have any speakers signed up?
Yes, sir. Mr. Chairman, we have one speaker, Carlton Lohr, resident of Louisa County. You can come forward.
My name is Carlton Lohr. My parents were Luther and Abby Lohr. They bought the land the Christensen moved to from a fellow named Taft who had a horse farm, I mean a cattle farm there. They developed Hillcrest Subdivision. The residue is the property that these people bought. So when my mother passed, I had a realtor, Adriana Waddy, and she suggested that'd be a beautiful place for a small horse farm. So I called the zoning office. I don't remember who I spoke to, but they said they saw no problem, you know, with it being such a large tract of land with good water, for that to be granted. So the Christensens, I understand, through their realtor, did the very same thing. And actually, we've only spoken once prior to shaking hands right now. They moved in, met them. I had to give some keys back to them. Very nice people. They're taking very good care of the property. I suggest to you that my father had ducks and geese and sticking their heads through the fence, eating the Christensen's grass, or horses on two sides of that, I mean, cattle on two sides of that border. I think that the town and the county would be enhanced by some beautiful horses on a well-maintained piece of property, much like 231 coming from Charlottesville in that area. And I would very much appreciate if you would think, if you left your beloved animals back in Colorado that you had full intention of having here with you, how would you feel if this was not granted? Thank you.
Thank you, Carl.
No further speakers.
Okay. Close public hearing. Discussion. Motion.
Move we approve the special use permit with the conditions as attached.
In my district, I'll second that.
Discussion.
Discussion.
Okay.
If you have more.
I'm assuming that these conditions are allow the owners to do what they're trying to do. I mean, I sometimes conditions are imposed, and sometimes they're consensus developed, and I don't know how these came about. So, is there?
Chairman Brooks of the Planning Commission, as you might know from your time as the liaison, he's pretty accustomed to asking the applicant if they agree to the conditions. And under the Christensen, so they were fully in agreement with what you had before you.
Okay.
So I don't think there was any disagreement there.
Okay. I mean, they're not completely onerous. But no farm animals shall be penned or cooped, it goes on to say, on the western part of the property. And my first reaction was, if I have horses, I might want to graze them in various places. And, you know, I do it all the time with my horses. I put up a piece of poly wire and graze them wherever the grass is. And so, you know, just little things like that. I would hate for us to consider a violation particularly on a temporary basis, using up grass that's available. So, I'm not looking for reasons to cause trouble here, but I'm really want to make sure that we're allowing them to accomplish what they're trying to accomplish with this SUP. We shouldn't put them through the process if they don't end up being able to do what they set out.
We'll clarify that the application, if you'll see in there, their intent was not even to use that side of the property anyway, because it's what you would consider part of the subdivision itself. So
I don't know the details of how it lays, so I can't. Yeah.
Mr. Frame, just a point of clarification. Your recommendation was as recommended by the Planning Commission? Your motion.
Yes.
Just one quick comment. I believe they said they asked for the four horses, but probably won't have more than two. Probably what they'll have on the property. They when they spoke to the Planning Commission, they were very amicable to the guidelines set forth.
Okay.
Mr. White, were you concerned about the 50 feet from the stream bank? Is that what you were?
No, item B. It says no farm animals shall be penned or cooped. And I'm thinking more about horses, not the fowl. Because I guess you could argue that a polywire is a pen. Not sure I would, but.
Do you have an aerial load or not?
Do you mean both the GIS or just the aerials that you had on your staff report?
Whatever's clever.
This one be well, a thing?
Didn't cloud. Everybody drive by today except Mark?
Yeah, I guess all I was asking.
I drove by about a week ago.
The stream bank.
Drove up behind it and everything.
Is the stream bank on that west end?
It runs.
When I looked at it, I couldn't tell how much of the property was.
Was on, and was, that's what.
Al, can we switch screens so I can show them?
Terribly annoying.
We just had a discussion on this topic a couple hours ago.
Trying to get to the yes.
Trying to get to the disclaimer, can't get to it.
Try plan B.
I can actually call it up on Esri if you like. In fact, I will.
So if you read the letter from Culpeper Saline Water. This is actually part of the York watershed, which has a TMDL established for it, which is a total maximum daily load of nutrients that can go into that. So it's something we do, I'm not gonna use the term obligation to abide by, but where we have land use decisions that can negatively impact that TMDL, we should be very mindful of that. So that was the purpose behind that condition. This is Google Maps. I think if you see before you, obviously don't have the parcel lines on here because this is Google, but the stream runs, if you follow my cursor right there, which is basically the dividing right there. And then this is the piece.
And I guess that was my concern. It's a fairly significant percentage of the property over there, and it looked like it was a grassed area.
Right.
And I guess my question is, what is our intent? Do we want no animals over there? Anytime, anyway, anyhow, or what are we?
Just to protect the neighbors from any. I mean, obviously that was a residential subdivision, and again, that's not the applicant did not request to have that use on that part of land. So we usually follow with what the applicant requests when we do our conditions.
Josh, how far is it from the from tree line to tree line there? Say, 100 feet off of the road, or what? Yeah, down along in there. How far is that across there?
This side right here?
Yeah.
It's about 300 feet.
Yeah, 325 feet.
So the 50 feet is somewhere around a sixth or a seventh of the width there.
Well, what's amazing is we're talking about this for versus something that's 8/10 of an acre that someone's using as. So, our zoning and usage is crazy.
Okay.
Where did D come from? How you got that on there?
Dealing with the transfer of the SUP, Josh?
That's borrowing on consistency with past SUPs like this, the board typically establishes a condition that they're not transferable to non-family. So we just, in keeping what the board has typically done with these.
I hesitate to do this, but I asked the question of someone earlier this evening about this. I said, is there a reason that we didn't have a conversation with the landowners about turning this whole parcel into ag for getting an SUP?
The question did come up, but the...
I mean, that's the pertinent question as far as I'm concerned.
Would have required both the rezoning and a comprehensive plan amendment.
Rezoning, yes. Comprehensive plan, I would argue. Our lines aren't quite fine enough to distinguish a boundary
parcel,
between an existing existing ag and an existing R.
Not to be argumentative, we do know our lines. That is the dividing line right there. So we gave them the cheaper option there. That's what they chose to do.
Okay. In my opinion, it's probably not the preferred option, but...
I do agree with you. If the applicant's happy with it, I guess it's the... But I find it very ironic that... Yeah. Just...
I've made enough trouble.
All right, we have a motion and a second. You're content now. Anything else? Does this require a roll call?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's what I thought. Roll call, please.
Mr. Johnson?
Aye.
Mr. Crozier?
Aye.
Mr. White?
Aye.
Mr. Goodwin?
Aye.
Mr. Franklin?
Aye.
Carries
5-0. Go forth and have little horses and ducks. Okay. Move on to hearing number two, application for the fire company to operate a digital sign.
From farm animals to signs. The
signs about farm animals.
Perhaps. Mr. Chairman, as you just said, the Barbersville Fire Company, their property is actually split zoned, if you may recall from the Barbersville Overlay District we did. The main facility there on the front, approximately 300 feet from the road, is all zoned R1 as well. Signage regulations are understandably very limited in R1 zoning, but it does give you all the ability to grant a special use permit to exceed those guidelines, and that's what the company has applied for, and which you are hearing this evening. The request is to install... It's a little misleading based on what you see in the package. It's a traditional signage on top and then a digital portion on the bottom. Total dimensions of that are 4x8, so 32 square feet. And similar with the past special use permit application, the Planning Commission heard this on their June 1st regular meeting, and similarly voted to recommend approval to you all with the conditions that you see before you in your packet. And Planning Commission made no changes to that. So I'll stop babbling right there and open up questions.
What is A, the digital display would be dimmed? What does that mean, dimmed?
So these digital signs are pretty, I'm sure you know, pretty advanced now. That gives them internal control from inside the building to adjust.
So it doesn't mean cut off, it just literally means dim.
Correct, just not the normal nighttime brightness or daytime brightness.
So what is the, is there an industry standard of dimming that all signs are that way, or is it on a rheostat, so you know?
It's a good question. It'd be an objective condition for sure, but
okay.
I could probably find a lumens measurement if
you'd
like.
Please don't.
Thank you. I don't want to do that.
I have a business past me that Mr. Goodwin frequents, and that was one of their conditions, and most absurd thing I've ever seen.
What's that?
A kennel. Lights at a kennel.
Oh.
It's
in the middle of nowhere.
Yes.
All right. Any other questions, Josh?
applicants wish to say anything?
At your peril, you know.
I'm not very good at this. Jeff,
how many horses do you intend to keep?
No. And which side of the creek are you going to put them on? I want to know now.
Yeah, hopefully, I won't get that. I'm Jeff Buck, 3238 Spotswood Trail, Baltimore, Virginia. President of a fire company. As you can see, our sign we have now is pretty old and ragged looking. So we just wanted to kind of upgrade a little bit. Do some advertise the bingo we have every Friday night. Advertise recruitment.
Is that the only thing the sign is used for?
Yeah, and every once in a while, like we put congratulations for the graduates this week.
The placement of the sign, is it approximately where the temporary sign is going to is now?
I think we're actually setting it back a little bit further to get it a little bit more on level ground, I believe.
Back toward the parking lot a little bit.
Yes, sir.
I mean, there's a plat in here, but my eyes didn't let me determine whether or not it was located exactly. I mean, I see something penciled in there.
I think part of it, because of that swale, they have to put it back.
Yeah, okay, that's probably what it is. Okay.
Make it work.
Yeah, okay.
Any other questions of the applicant? Okay.
Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you, Jeff.
In that case, open the public hearing. Do we have any speakers?
No, sir, Mr. Chairman.
Close the public hearing.
Mr. Chairman, you do have a letter from Mrs. Maupin, Matthew.
Yes.
Maupin, that she asked me to distribute to all of you all in support of the application.
Okay. Motion?
I move we approve.
Second. Motion is second. Discussion?
Yes, I would like to see us, and this is not a part of the motion, but because once again we're here deciding what we can and can't do on a public or semi-public facility, I would like to see our zoning ordinance changed to go ahead and make it so that fire stations, rescue stations, public buildings can be anywhere, like most jurisdictions in this state. I'm sick and tired of having to go through every time a volunteer company wants to do something, or if the county wants to do something, we have to go through some special use permit where any other jurisdiction I know in the Commonwealth of Virginia doesn't have to go through all this. That's just my comment.
Okay.
And I think it's a very good looking sign.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, indeed.
We'll let you come out to District 1 occasionally and look at it.
I appreciate it.
There's a nice park across the street.
Go ahead and play bingo.
Yes, that's right.
You come out on a Friday and we'll take some money from it.
Not a problem.
Is that transference of funds from one? Anything else? All right. Roll call.
Mr. Goodwin?
Aye.
Mr. White?
Aye.
Mr. Johnson?
Aye.
Mr. Frame?
Aye.
Mr. Crozier?
Aye.
Carries 5-0. Now we have a sign advertising a McDuckson.
Thank you all.
We'll tie the horses up.
Okay. Just don't coop them up.
All right, that takes care of all the regular public business we have, so we should go back.
Motion to continue the closed session.
Okay. Are we going to do
the agritourism restaurant from the work session?
Yeah, the work session.
Okay.
That's please. Why Josh is still here. Please. He would have left 30 seconds ago otherwise.
make him sit.
Appreciate the mercy. Gentlemen, if you can recall from 2 weeks, or I guess that was 2 weeks ago, you all adopted a basic zoning ordinance amendment that allows for agritourism restaurants in the agricultural zoning district. Our further instruction from the board is to develop a policy document. So that is back before you this evening. It should have been part of your packet. We looked at the intent of the comprehensive plan and what it would lead us to draft a basic set of conditions that would basically give you a common ground by which you could judge any of these applications that you might get in the future. So on page 2 of this memo, you'll see our recommendation to you. And I'll entertain any questions or suggestions or any further guidance.
I would suggest that you have a statement in there that this restaurant is complementary to the principal agritourism activity, not necessarily the principal activity in itself. In other words, the restaurant is complementing a whatever agritourism activity they have, as opposed to being the principal activity.
Are you inserting that? Is that a new bullet, or is that
another
placing?
Bullet.
Okay.
A bullet, or you could put it in the front paragraph, just something to that extent.
Josh, tell me a little bit about the 5,000 gross square feet. I'm trying to understand why we would include the outdoor seating area in that number.
It's not as arbitrary as you might think. We kind of looked at your
that's where I always start. I assume it's arbitrary. Yeah. As you know.
Fair enough. We look at your typical downtown type restaurant and the space it occupies, and we try to look at the scale of the restaurant. And what we find is that those type of restaurants typically be in the nature of 4,000 to 6,000 square feet on average. So we picked the middle of the two, and that was it.
What about the outdoor seating area? That was the part that I was trying to. I mean, if it's a structure, you know, with a roof on it or something like that, then I get it. If it's just
a patio
or a bunch of picnic tables
or picnic
under trees.
Tables, yeah, scattered amongst the oak trees, yeah.
I didn't want to go completely crazy, but I was trying to understand why we would include the outdoor seating area there, unless it was, you know, a deck off the restaurant or something like that, then it probably, I'm not sure we want to be, you know,
that restricted.
That restricted or that broad. Like I said, what came into my mind were a bunch of picnic tables under some oak trees scattered over half an acre.
Oops, we exceed 5,000.
Ergo Montpelier. The way it used to be, anyway. It's not that way anymore, but no. It was.
So I guess we could either clarify what we mean as attached, adjacent outdoor seating areas, or we could just strike it all together. Just keep in mind that gives the ability to circumvent the intent of this if we do that.
Yeah, I mean, I think I would be okay with a refinement that more clearly says what we're trying to restrict in covered seating, you know, patio deck, maybe, yeah, but you know, sort of other truly outdoor things, I don't know. I can't think of any examples other than the way Montpelier was many years ago. But
yeah, how would you know if somebody came up and said, we got a whole bunch of picnic tables out here, and they're the area that they cover is greater than 5,000 square feet. How would you interpret that using this set of words?
Are they serving booze or not?
Well, I mean, to an extent, these are guidelines.
Right? I understand.
So I guess from Joshua's point of view, I could say that the board would have the flexibility to be fairly liberal if it's picnic tables in a grove of trees as opposed to patio with maybe a lattice roof or something overhead but no walls. That would be sort of part of the building, whereas picnic tables would not be.
I think we could probably put in some and the like type information, you know, attached patios, like you just said, decks.
Well, given this is guidelines, somebody coming up here and he's got 5,000 square feet of under roof and he wants to put a porch around it or something like that, that adds another 2,000 square feet. That would be pretty evident, and you could tell them that's probably not going to fly. But if they got a bunch of picnic tables out there, just
as guidelines, I don't see it as that bad. If we're actual policy, then
well, believe you me, guidelines get turned into policy all the time.
Well,
I have a couple pending right now.
Well, but if we're going to have, I think we did ask for guidelines to be drawn up to give people an idea. So you can't have guidelines but not have them.
We asked for
guidelines.
Either have them or you don't.
And you can't have them and not apply.
Or a guidance sheet.
I mean, believe it or not, I'm going to shock Josh. I think as a guideline, this is fine. I would agree with the point Jim's making. If this becomes some kind of hard and fast thing where we're going to hold people to this, no, I don't agree with that, because I think that violates the spirit of guidelines. I mean, and it doesn't allow for the picnic tables in the grove of trees or you know, that type of more informal seating, which is totally different from somebody sort of skating through by not putting walls around it. We get into the weirdest cul-de-sacs.
Because the reality is, the guidelines are, you're going to see each one of these, you guys are going to see each one as an SUP. So, I mean, Josh, the guidelines don't give Josh some tool to now prevent these from happening, because every SUP is still going to come to you guys and you'll determine.
Right. I saw these when Josh and I working through the drafting of it as an application. Here's what the board's guidance is. If you go above or below, you'll need some rational explanation as part of your SUP why that you're above or below or not in line with it, and then that becomes part of y'all's deliberations.
I would be
all this is there for is to tell the people when they come in going, I want to. Okay, that doesn't work. Refines it before it ever gets to us.
If he comes in with a good plan with 4,000 square feet out inside and another 1,200 feet outside, so we got 5,200 square feet, and it looks nice.
In the middle of a 1,000-acre parcel.
Mm-hmm. Sure, yeah. We're probably not going to get excited about it.
Agreed.
But if he came in with 12,000 square foot under roof, we probably wouldn't find that.
Kind of like the Busch Gardens Fest House
gift shop
approach.
As long as they don't have a pool table.
Exactly. Or sell chainsaws.
All right.
So I guess the action here is if the board.
If you are comfortable, you can adopt as amended or adopt as presented.
I would move we adopt as amended.
I'll second that.
Further discussion? All in favor say,
yeah.
That's all I need, okay. Just got to check now.
Ordinances and resolutions.
Yeah. All in favor say aye.
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 Okay. Let it be done.
All right.
Now.
Now we go back upstairs.
Unrecess.
I make a motion that we resume our session.
Motion, second.
Yeah, it might be all.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Okay, we're back.
What did you say? I can multitask. Members of the board, to the best of your knowledge, were the only matters discussed in the closed meeting, public business matters lawfully exempted from open meeting requirements, and that only such public business matters as were identified in the motion by which the closed meeting was convened were heard, discussed, or considered in the closed meeting. Mr. Goodwin?
Aye.
Mr. Crozier?
Aye.
Mr. Frame?
Aye.
Mr. Johnson?